Hello, good morning. We're right here at the Father's house, in the sanctuary of the Father's house, and the Word of God is coming to you. It is so exciting to have opportunity to minister to you. You know, this is very strange because usually we have many, many people inside the house, and you get a chance to speak and see the people. So I have to see you prophetically, but I do believe that what God's about to say this day is something that's going to impact your life. And I really believe also that there are so many people that are looking for answers. They're looking for answers during this crisis. So that's why we named this message, even from last week, even to this week, the same thing. Christ is above the crisis. Christ is above the crisis. So as we open up, just a couple of things I want to bring to your attention as we talk about this. One of the things we have to have our prayer closets have to be full. So I challenged last week, and I'm challenging you this week, to join me in prayer from 5 to 7. Join me in prayer from 5 to 7. Now, you can choose a 30-minute interval. It can be 5 o'clock to 5:30. It can be 6 o'clock to 6:30, however you want to do it. But I'm saying join me in prayer. And I want you to pray about certain things. I want to give this to you right now. Now, let me just say this. Please don't take this as though I'm just kind of encouraging you because I want you to be busy. During this message, I'm going to tell you some things that I believe are clearly from God. I do believe I have a word from God in this crisis. So also, let me just, before I go any further, those that are here, I want you to share. I want you to like and share. Make comments if you like. Engage with me. What I'm saying to you, I do believe if you do this, some of you know how to use Facebook and do watch parties. Whatever you want to do, however you want to share this, go on and do that now, as you're a part of this with, because we want as many people to hear this word, I believe that the whole generation needs to hear. So I want you to pray between 5 and 7. Now, I won't know that you're praying, but God will know that you're praying. One, I want you to pray for our governmental leaders. Now, this includes the President of the United States, the Vice President of the United States. It includes the governor. It includes your mayor. You pray for them because they are making decisions every day on your safety. And whether or not to do a shelter in place and all these different things, and whether or not to quarantine. So, and I'm going to just say this. It has a lot to do also with even the churches. This is free expression of religion, even our opportunity to worship. So I just want to be clear to you that right now you have to pray for these guys and what they're doing. Number two, I want you to pray in the context of this about your own family. So therefore, pray Psalms 91 over your family. Do not play around, because I'm going to tell you what, that spirit of corona will come to your family if you don't pray. You got to say, as for me and my house, we're serving the Lord. My house is protected. So pray over your family and everybody that means something to you. Pray over them by name. Do that now. Thirdly, I want you to pray over the church. I believe that the Bible says judgment starts in the house of God. So what the church does right now is very critical in regard to this coronavirus. You say, well, how does the church have something to do with it? In every case, anything that goes on that God is doing or he's even allowing to happen, he's looking for the response of the church. So I want you to pray for your church, pray for your church family also, so that God will protect your church family, but also pray that the remnant will come forth, that the fivefold ministry will come forth. You know, the apostles, prophets, pastors, teachers, evangelists, let come forth, because the word of God will be declared during this time. And then lastly, I want you to pray because for the spread of the gospel throughout all the world. A global pandemic, I'm saying the pandemic is the word of God. The pandemic is the word of God that has to be spread throughout the whole world. So let's pray for that, and that this is the beginning of revival and a true awakening. That's what you want to pray during that time. So encouraging you to fill your prayer closets. And I'm going to tell you something. I know that the devil is fighting you because you want to be entertained. You want to entertain your soul. So therefore, you want to look at, you know, the Netflix movies. And I've looked at them. You want to look and see what's on Hulu, what's on the television. But I want to challenge you to tell you that you cannot allow CNN, MSNBC, NBC, CBS, Fox News, none of that should be feeding your spirit. I want to ask you a question. What is feeding your spirit right now? What's feeding your spirit? what I'm saying to you is that the word of God, this right here, must feed you. Otherwise, you'll be fed with so much pandemic information that you'll take on the fears of the pandemic as opposed to faith in the word of God. So I want to just encourage you and say this to you, that the Spirit of God has to be more involved in this than the spirit of the media. Because otherwise, you'll take on the fears, you take on the panic, you'll take on the hysteria, all these things. So do understand what is feeding your spirit during this time. In the context of that, I want to also say that we want to encourage you to give. I will mention it to this part and as well as the last part, but those of you who are part of our church, those of you that are out here that don't even have a church home, some of you are not tithing the way you should. So just because we're in this situation where we're not having worship together, don't use that as an excuse not to give. So give to the ministry. Give to the ministry. So we have different ways to give. You can see there on the screen. There are different ways that we have to give. One is you can give through, we have a push pay app. You can give toward that. And then also you can text. And this is the most easy way to do it. It's easy. You can just text 77977. And then you call that number, and then you put in TFHATL, TFHATL, and then it pushes you right in there where you can put your information, and you'll find that you'll be able to give very easily. And then some of you are old school, you want to send a check in, you can send it right here, the 6060 Spalding, here in Norcross, Georgia. So I want to say that to you. Let me jump back in. This is so very important, but let me pray first. I want you to be a part of this. And by the way, I know that there are thousands right now of live streaming messages going forth. Thousands. But I want to just say this to you, that you got to lock in on something. So if you locked in right now, you listen to me through this message. I guarantee you the things that I'm going to say that's going to bless you and give you hope, as well as give you discernment of what God is doing. So do not switch around. You can go to something else later, but you want to tone into me now. Let me just pray for you. Lord, I just pray right now that the Holy Spirit will move like never before. I just pray by your Spirit, Lord, that you would bring us together. No matter when a person sees it, even if it's live streaming, or Lord, if it's a time where they come back and see the recorded, whatever the time, it's their time. I just pray, Father, that you are the God over the time. You're over space. So, Lord, this can be right now seen around the world with the internet. So I pray, Lord, by the power of God and the grace of God, that, Lord, you would minister your word of truth in power and strength and hope and joy and conviction. Lord, I pray, Father, that this technology will work on your behalf. So, Lord, bless you for this time now as we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. So I want to pick up, if you saw last week's message, and even if you didn't, go back and see it, because I was talking about how Nehemiah was told about the broken wall of Jerusalem and that how that he was burdened by it. And I want to say this. I said this last week. I'm going to say it again. I do understand you being burdened. It's appropriate. We're all burdened. We're burdened when you start seeing the numbers escalating from China to Italy, Europe, now United States. It's escalating those that have the virus. When you start seeing the numbers of people that seemingly are dying as a result of it. So it does burden you. So even Nehemiah was burdened. So the burden isn't the problem. The burden is what is the reaction. So if your reaction is just, I will listen and then I'll take it in and then I take on the fear. No, that's not it. We don't want the fear to take over. We want then you to say, I will pray. Nehemiah prayed. What he did was he went and he cried out to God and he said, Lord, we have sinned. Now the wall was broken down just like this pandemic has hit. And so he says, we have sinned. So right now, we got to recognize that even as I told you to pray in your prayer closets, I'm saying even now, I want you to pray, Lord, we have sinned, cry out to God, because therefore, that should be our initial response to God. And then ask him, Lord, for mercy. So, Lord, we're sorry. We're sorry for all the things that we've done. So in the context of that, that's the most important thing. Now, let's go on and get into the word. Hebrews chapter 12, let me just start here. There's so much I want to say to you. Hebrews, yeah, say right there where you are. Slow down, Bishop. That's right, thank you. Because I do, there's so much I want to tell you, and in this little time, I probably don't have the time to tell you. So I'm also, let me tell you something else I'm doing, just to interrupt myself. I'm doing a personal Zoom on Thursday at 7:30. So I'll encourage you to be a part of it. Certainly, the church family is a part. I encourage all of you, if you want to join in to Zoom, doing a Bible study, listen to this, of faith in the crisis. Faith in the crisis. So if you go to our Facebook page, it'll show you how to lock on, and we'll show you how to get in there with the Zoom. And then you can see my face, and we'll talk again about this. So very important. But now, Hebrews chapter 12, this is verse 26 to 29. And this is something that I'm dealing with because I thought I had this thing under control in terms of understanding what God was doing. But I realized that God's doing something. He's shaking the earth. Now look at this. It says, whose voice then shook the earth, but now he had promised, saying, yet once more I will shake not the earth only, but also the heavens. And this is the voice of the Lord speaking. He said, and this word, yet once more, signified the removing of those things that can be shaken. So first of all, he says, I'm going to shake not only the earth, I'm going to shake the heavens. This is his promise. But go keep on there. It says now, it says, as these things that are made, that those things that cannot be shaken will remain. So he's going to shake everything. Everything's going to be shaken. And even unless you are in the foundation of Christ, you will be shaken too. Right now, he's shaking the earth. Listen to this. Not just here, but the whole earth is being shaken. So you got to say that if the whole earth is being shaken, how in the world can we make it unless we find ourselves, listen to this, firmly rooted and grounded and foundational Christ. You understand what I'm saying? That there is no way that we ourselves can maintain, listen to this, our firm stand while he's shaking this earth unless we have a firm foundation. So in this regard, let me just, I saw this other thing written right here I thought was very good. Oh, by the way, the rest of that scripture, you don't want to miss that, because the very end it talks about that God is a consuming fire, and he is. He's a devouring fire. So we cannot understand, we can in any way underestimate what God's doing in this process. So anyway, it goes on here and says, now this is not the scripture, but I'm just talking to you now. Do you realize that in a very short time, all the things that have happened here. Listen to this. He brought the plagues of Egypt. Listen to this. And then he started dealing with the things that we worship. In this time, it's almost like he's touched everything that's important to us. Everything is important. Like, for instance, he says, I've taken away things that you worship. What was that? Well, you worship athletes. Listen to this. The whole stadiums and arenas are shut down. You worship athletes, and then in the process of that, you find out that you find out that you have a shutdown of the athletes, and you shut down the NBA, and you shut down March Madness, and you find out that it's not even working. So what happens as a result of it? Then you shut down the civic centers. So then you go, and then you talk about you worship the actors. And then you shut down the theaters. And then you say, well, you worship money. Guess what? He shut down the economy and collapsed the stock market. All these things are happening. And then, listen to this, then you don't want to go to church. He shut down the church. What I'm saying to you is that we have to realize that not one bomb was exploded. Not one missile has been launched, but yet he shut things down that seemingly have taken the place of God. And I'm telling you right now, it's a very serious time that we're here. So maybe it's not so much a vaccine that we need right now. Maybe we need to find that maybe we need some time with God in this isolation. During this isolation, we need to get away from all the distractions. Every distraction, we have to get away from it. And listen to this. And then have a personal revival with God. Listen to this. We need a personal revival. Well, in other words, during this isolation, sometimes you think about isolation, then you introspect. During your isolation, you should look at yourself. In the process of this, while this is going on, then you say, well, Lord, what do you expect of me? So you understand, you're asking these questions, Lord, what is it that you're expecting of me while I'm in isolation? So in the process, so what we do while we're secluded, while we're in self-quarantine, it's so very important that we don't just entertain our flesh. But man, we're in a place where we're saying, Lord, I got to spend time with God. I have many of you told me this. I've even said this, that I just don't have time to really spend time with God like I want. I need to go to work. Well, guess what? Now you don't even have to go to work. Many of you are spending time literally at home working. So now the question is, am I willing to get up? Am I willing to spend time with Him? Some of you now can spend 30 minutes down. You can spend literally 3 hours with God, 6 hours with God. Are you willing? Are you willing to spend that time, that kind of time? In other words, when He gives you the opportunity, are you able to get over there in His presence and literally seek Him? I'm going to tell you something. The church right now is really being in a place where it's being checked out. We got to find out where we are. We have to figure out where we are as a church. And to be honest with you, let me just come over here for a second. I'm really concerned. I really am. Because I realize that sometimes we depend on the physical place. But once we're separated, it's almost like we're out here by ourselves. Listen to this, without accountability. So the question is then, how much do we serve God intentionally when we're not accountable? Because right now in the church, you see each other, you dress up for church, everybody sees you. So at least one time a week, well, I say one time a week, some of y'all come once a month, but from there. When I grew up, it was not a question whether or not I was going to be in church. No matter what I did on Saturday night, even as a teenager, I knew that I had to be in church. So it wasn't a question of church attendance. You don't even seemingly have to attend the church. So your sin is not even being managed. No accountability. So this is a time where the church really can see where the church is, and more specifically, we ourselves can judge where we are. I mean, is this too much for you? I mean, okay, maybe you do want to go to hear somebody else. Because I'm challenging you because I really do believe that God has His hand pointed to us. It's not like He's saying to us that I'm releasing you so you can go and you can go home and just chill. You can go home and don't pray. I'm not there. No, He's saying in your household, if you sheltered in place, self-quarantined, how much of God is really there with you? How much do you spend time with Him? Now, I'm going to tell you something. It's challenging. I will admit that. Because in reality, God definitely wants to get our attention. He has to. What is this about? This is all about getting the attention of the church. Well, what about the nation? What about the nations of the earth? Yeah, they're involved too. Do you know God can be doing several things at one time? It's interesting that something like this, He can touch different parts of the world, have different messages that He's sending by one calamity.
So it's not like it's just one thing happening here, one thing happening there. But at the same time, he can deal with you. Just like your household, he's dealing with one thing. Maybe somebody else's household, he's dealing with another thing. And then all of us are going through different struggles and challenges, financial, maybe interrelated messages with our homes and our families and our communities and our marriages and our relationships. See, all these things are going on, but at the same time, he's dealing with us specifically, but at the same time, the same calamity may have a different message for all of us. So in this regard, listen to what I'm saying. He's getting our attention. Now, somebody told me in Amos chapter 4, we had a prayer meeting on the phone. I mean, I prayed with some leaders of the Lord on Saturday morning. And so they said to me, have you looked at Amos chapter 4? So I said, yeah, I thought I had. So I looked at Amos chapter 4, and I realized how frustrated sometimes God can be with us. How frustrated God can be with us. Amos chapter 4, it's amazing. I'm going to read out of the Living Translation. But if you go down to Amos chapter 4 and you get to verse 6, it says, I brought hunger to every city and famine to every town, but still you would not return to me. See, ultimately God is saying, return to me. Will you come back to me? He says, I've kept the rain from falling when your crops needed it most. I sent rain on one time,
and I withheld it from another. Rain fell in one field, while another field withered away. People staggered from town to town looking for water, but there was never enough. But still, the Bible says, you would not return to me, saith the Lord. Listen to this. He says, I struck your farms and your vineyards with blight and mildew. Locusts devoured all your figs and olive trees. But still, you would not return to me. I sent plagues on you, like plagues that I sent on Egypt long ago. I killed your young men in war. I led you through all your horses away. The stretch of stench, listen, the stench of death filled the air. But still, you would not return to me. One more group. I destroyed some of the cities as I destroyed Sodom and Gomorrah. Those of you who have survived are like charred sticks pulled from fire. You burned all the way. You're impacted by my judgment, but still, you did not return to me. Now, can you imagine God's frustration? So then this makes me ask this question, and I hate to ask this question because, you know, as a pastor, I want to see this thing broken. I want to see it gone. I want to get back to business as usual. But I got to ask the question, are we broken enough yet for God to break the virus? Oh, God. I know. Man, you want to change the station, don't you? I know. You don't want to hear this because this is what I'm saying. He's trying to get us to a place where we're broken. So, even though people are dying, people are afraid to come out of their house. People put on masks, people put on gloves, people putting cotton in their ears. They're doing everything they can, but they still can't prevent this thing from increasing. What I'm saying to you is that has God determined that we are broken enough yet? Even the church to cry out for mercy, have we broken enough to recognize that sin has been involved in this and he's trying to get our attention? So yes, I want to pray that virus go back to the pit of hell. And I'm telling you, I do pray that. I pray that they would go back to sender. I do pray that. But we have to still ask the Lord, what are you saying to us, the church? I don't know. What do you think? You think we're broken enough yet? How long does he have to do it? So Amos chapter 4, I dare you to read it. I dare you to read it yourself. Amos chapter 4 is very clear. That man, I did all the stuff that's going on at a whole nother level, and still they didn't come back to me. So what this does tell me is that this might not be the last thing. It's not. That God still may visit us. This just might be a trial run of some of the things we may experience. Look at just recently. We had there was a locust invasion that took place in Africa, basically Western Africa. It was Eastern Africa. It was a locust invasion. Look at this. Our volcanoes are erupting. We've had extreme weather. We've had fires, uncontrollable fires are going on. All these things are taking place, but yet, look at this, but yet, has it really gotten our attention? And now we have a coronavirus that's spread throughout the world. Do we recognize that we have to pray? Man, we're still battling about a Democrat, Republican, a stimulus package, all that. And listen, praise God, we got to stimulate the economy best we can. But do you know, unless God says, I'm going to break this, I'm going to stop it, the plague will continue. So I'm trying to get to the core. This is a spiritual issue. This is not a natural issue. I want you to pray for, please, I don't want to interrupt myself. Please pray for the first responders. Please pray for those in the hospitals. Pray for the doctors. But do you understand that even doctors and the nurses, some of them are getting infected? They're catching this virus? Man, it's unbelievable. But do you know it could get much worse before it gets better? So then I'm saying, let the Lord touch your heart. Say to the Lord, Lord, invite him in. Say, Lord, in the midst of this, Lord, show me some things. So show me some things about myself that you want to touch. As leaders, as pastors, I just want to repent to you. Because I do believe as pastors we want to increase our churches. We all do. There's not one pastor I know that doesn't want a large, healthy, successful church. But in order to do that, we basically have been told that you have to give a message that is seeker-friendly, or that at least it opens the door for people to hear the gospel, so it's not convicting. It doesn't challenge you. So therefore, you're teaching your people how to live an easy road, not necessarily preparing them for a hard road. So now, when tribulation comes, or situations like this come, all pastors, because if we were, you would naturally go into your prayer closet. I'm saying to you that it's not even a natural thing unless it comes to your doorstep. Now, if it comes to your doorstep, you're going to pray. If somebody in your house get the corona, oh, you're going to pray. Or somebody close to you. Yeah. But I'm saying to you, do you have enough of God inside of you to say, man, I got to seek God on behalf of my nation? I recognize you trying to get our attention. So as a pastor, I have to take responsibility for because I don't believe pastors in general are preparing the people for tribulation and child times like this. So anyway, let me just go to, I want to get over here and talk to you a little bit about this, see, in the time I have. So now, this theme here is about Christ being above the crisis. Now, the nature of a crisis is there's a certain urgency. There's a certain, sometimes a fear. There's a certain feeling about what you're doing. And so you care, you're concerned about it. You're burdened by it, as I said before. Well, one of the best examples of this was Lazarus, when Lazarus died. And I'm not going to go through all of this because you know some of the story. I just want to bring out certain parts of it that you can understand. Well, you know, initially the messengers came to Jesus and said that Lazarus, your friend, Lazarus, that Lazarus was close to death. And that basically they were saying, come to help Lazarus. Maybe if you come, Lazarus may not have to die. So what was Jesus' response? Jesus took 2 more days. Now, this is based out of, so if you want to follow it, go read it yourself. This is based out of John chapter 11, 1 through 26. So I'm not going to read all that, but I'm going to paraphrase some of it. So he said, told his disciples, well, we got work to do. We're involved with work. So he kept working while Lazarus actually was dying. So he kept working for 2 days. Then finally he got a witness. He said, you know what? Lazarus is asleep. I'm gonna go there. Well, if he's asleep, you're gonna wake him up. No. He's dead, but he's gonna live. So then he ends up taking a journey there to Bethany. Now listen to this. It was a day's journey to get to him. The messenger took a day to get to him. He took 2 days off to do it. Not to go back, but to do the work of the Lord. And then it took a day to get that back to where Lazarus was. So that's a 4-day period. They said he was buried for 4 days. So obviously during the time that messenger first went to Jesus, Lazarus was dead anyway. So as a result of that, he shows up. And that's where it comes in. What Martha says to him in verse 17, it says, when Jesus arrived at Bethany, he was told that Lazarus had already been in the grave for 4 days. And Martha got word that Jesus was coming. She went to meet him, but Mary stayed in the house. And Martha said to Jesus, and these are her famous words, Lord, if you only had been here, my brother would not have died. In other words, clearly, the time that you took to get here is the reason that my brother died. In other words, you didn't see the urgency? I sent a messenger for you. What she was basically saying, you could have made it here, Jesus, but you didn't. So we were in crisis. My brother was at the brink of death. I know you got the power to heal him, to deliver him. Now he's dead and it's over. In other words, Martha's crisis was, and her urgency was not Jesus' priority. He walked above it. He was walking above the crisis. When he came in, he said, listen, Martha, I am the resurrection and the life. I am the resurrection and the life. See, you can't get more deeper than that. In other words, I'm not moved by your urgency. So there are times in urgency. And let me just be clear about that. Urgency are things that deal with us. You know, it's like you got to deal with it now. It's the timing now. Everything's got to go separate now. Everything's got to be done right now. And Jesus said, wait a minute, time out. One day can be like 1,000 years, and 1,000 years can be one day. Do you understand this eternity here we're talking about? I'm not moved by it. Well, how long is it going to be? 2 weeks. It's going to be 2 months. How long is it going to last? That's up to God. But he's not lost control. So we have to see this thing the way God sees it. Okay, it's hard not to see it the way CNN sees it. It's hard not to see it the way the news is giving it to you. Social media is blazing. You take on the spirit of that. I'm telling you as a believer, if those of you that are Christian, you have to defy that right now. I defy the spirit of doubt, belief, and worry. I defy that spirit of fear of death. I defy that spirit that's trying to get on me, a panic and anxiety. I've seen so many anxious people. I mentioned that before. I'm going to say it again. Anxiety, not knowing what to expect. I think something is there. You got to break that thing, but you got to replace it with something. The Bible says, faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. I want to say to you is that you have to get the word of God in your daily intake. You have to eat the word. You have to meditate on the word in your daily intake. That's the only way that you're going to be able to counteract all the thing that's bombarding you every day. Yeah, because otherwise, the spirit of that thing will impact you. I mean, it's you know, the gamut of my friends right now are dealing with it. I mean, some people are so bad. I mean, at this point, I mean, you know, listen, even in my own household, man, we got a little table in the garage. We do. We got a little table in the garage where we try to wipe off things before they come in the house. And my wife's serious about it, too. She say, put that stuff right there. I'm going to wipe it off before we get in the house. That's good. Take your shoes off. That's good. But I'm just saying, ultimately speaking, we can't keep that virus from hitting us. Ultimately, we still have to have faith. And Jesus, it looked like with Nazareth, Lazarus was about to, was dead, and it looked like he didn't even bother him. And why? I mean, I'm the answer to this stuff. So in other words, our crisis is not Jesus' crisis. This is another one. Okay, you remember this story? I know you know it. They were on the boat. The Bible says here in Mark chapter 4. And let's see, is that where I want to go? Come with me over here. Yeah, Mark chapter 4 and verse 35. Yes. So it says, we're going to pass over on the other side. See? We're going to pass over on the other side. Mark chapter 4, verse 35. And so they were all, you know, sent away the multitude, and even Jesus was in the ship. And of course, they went out, and there arose what a great storm of wind. A great storm of wind. The winds beat the ship so much so that the water came in. And I've said this before, you know, the issue is not so much what goes on the outside. The ship might can handle it, but when the water starts coming in the ship, it begins to sink. So now these guys were very concerned, and so they went down to where Jesus was. The Bible says that King James says he was in the hinder part of the ship. Anyway, he was at the bottom of the ship. But it says he was asleep on a pillow. He was asleep. Man, the whole ship was bouncing around. Water was coming. Jesus was asleep. They said, Jesus, Master, carest not that we perish. In other words, don't you care that we're about to die? You're going to sit here and sleep, man, while we're about to die? Do you realize what's going on? Don't you care? So the other thing about this corona, that it's also a fear, it's a fear of death. Fear of death. Don't you care that we perish? Jesus, you're going to just let it happen? You know, some people say, well, how can God let bad things happen to good people? You need to read your Bible. Someone just said, God will take thousands of people out to get our attention. Let me say this. If we don't respond right, Jesus himself was in the back of the boat. You know what happened now? He was in the helm of the thing. He woke up. I woke him up. Matter of fact, some of y'all don't even like to be shaken out of your sleep. Now you shook him out of his sleep. So he probably had an attitude. Jesus had an attitude. Well, it looks like it. Because what he said was he arose. He said, and he rebuked the wind and said unto the wind, peace be still. Now, I was on a prayer call this week. And again, this prayer call is really good. This Saturday. One of the gentlemen that started praying and talked about, I feel like I have a peace in the midst of this. And I realized that that's the greatest thing we can walk in, because it's hard to be in faith if you don't have peace. So a lot of the agitation, a lot of the concern comes from lack of peace. So the Bible talks about peace, exceeding peace. A peace that comes from the Lord, a peace that passes all understanding. So that's another thing, you guys, as you pray. Pray for the peace of God within my heart. I refuse to allow for the devil to give me agitation, annoyance, fear, and panic. I refuse that. Lord, give me peace in the midst of the storm. He spoke peace. And then, of course, the Bible says the wind ceased and there was a great calm. And he said to them, now this is the attitude. Why are you yet so fearful? Is that you have, it's almost like you have no faith. Okay, I can't imagine him saying those words without a little attitude. Because these are his disciples. I'm in the boat with you. Man, it's like he told Martha, I am the resurrection. You think that something's going to happen and I'm here? I'm not telling you you won't go through things. This is the other part about our Christianity. Sometimes we think that we're not going to go through things. Yeah, you're going to go through it, but I'll be with you in the storm. I'll give you peace in the midst of the storm. I'll give you peace in the midst of a coronavirus that probably may get worse before it gets better. Oh, Bishop, don't say that. Please tell me it's going to be over. I don't know. But I'm telling you right now that God wants us to surrender to him and see things from Christ's perspective. What is that? From Christ's perspective, what he's saying is that I am not going to be moved by your crisis. Got to walk above it. Got to walk above it. Now, let me give you one more. One more. You know this one, too. All these are things that you learn in Sunday school, and all, but you got to see it in the context of this corona spirit. And I'm not minimizing it. This thing, it's death. People are dying. So, another boat situation, same situation. So of course, he sends them over. This is actually taken out of Matthew chapter 14, 22. I want you to understand it, though. But he says, Matthew 14, 22, says immediately after this, Jesus insisted that his disciples go back into the boat and cross over to the other side of the lake while he sent people home, because they were all following him, and sending them home, he went up into the hills and by himself to pray. And then he says, nightfall came. And then the disciples were in trouble, far from the Lord. He was away from the Lord. A strong wind had risen, and they were fighting heavy waves. Okay, they got in trouble again. This time, Jesus wasn't there, though. Jesus was somewhere else. So then it says about 3 o'clock a.m. in the morning, Jesus comes toward them, walking on the water. Walking. They thought it was a ghost. So it says, he said, what is it? They were terrified and feared. Jesus was coming. Man, sometimes we got to discern. He said, I'm going to do a new thing. Shall you not know it? I do believe sometimes God's trying to say some things to us, and we so compare everything in the natural that when God's doing something spiritual, we don't even recognize that Jesus is right there. Because we want him to respond to us in the way that we think he should respond. So he came walking on the water. So, of course, when Paul, you know the story, Peter said, well, Lord, if that's you, what bid me to come? And he said, well, come on. And so he started jumping out. So we, again, this is a simple story. When the waves started looking, started getting crazy, of course, he looked at the waves and took his eyes off Jesus. And so when he did, he began to sink. Listen to this. If you take eyes off the solution and the answer, Jesus is the answer. Alpha and Omega. He's the beginning and the end. He is the control. But if we look at what we're fearful of, if we panic in the midst of this pandemic, if we panic, then we will drown. We'll drown under it. We'll submerge to it. We'll submerge under it. But if we continue to walk over it like Jesus was, I'm telling you right now, God's calling us to a new place. He is. He's calling us to a new place. We're not called to fall under the situation, but we're called to walk above it. That's what Christ is. Christ is above the crisis. I just want to pray with you right now. I trust that you've heard something. And I know sometimes I get excited, I raise my voice, but I'm just filled with passion about this. I really am. Lord, am I open enough? And I have to ask myself this. I'm telling you things that I have to pray. Do you know that there are so many different pastors right now and ministers that have a different approach to this? I'm praying every day, Lord, what are you saying to me? because I want to be able to communicate to you appropriately. So to do that, God's got to deal with us, each one of us, house to house, family to family, prayer closet to prayer closet. So I just want to pray with you right now. Please join me in prayer. Very important. Lord, I just pray right now by the Spirit of God that you would visit us. Visit us in a household. Visit us, oh God, when we spend time with you. Lord, I pray, even if it seems like we're having a hard time because we're overtaken by information. We're overtaken by social media. We're overtaken, Lord, but I pray, Father, that we can pull away, cut off the television, cut off the phones, cut off the social media, and just spend time with you. I pray for supernatural empowerment into the prayer closets of your home. I pray for supernatural empowerment of the Spirit of God that's within you, for greater is he that's within you, the Spirit of God within you, than he that's within the world. I call forth prophetically that you shall live and not die. I call forth protection over your home, but I also call forth a determination to do the will of God beyond surrendering. Beyond surrendering. Lord, also, if there's anybody listening to me that doesn't know you as your personal Lord and Savior, I also pray that you would capture them, even by this word, capture them that they may know you as Lord and Savior. Also, by the way, we're going to take an offering. Now, I did it at the beginning. How to do it? Number one is that you have different ways to give. They're going to put it on the screen. You can text to give. That's probably the easiest thing, text to give. Listen, don't let this crisis take you out because you stop doing the things that you know to do as a Christian. And if you're not a part of a church and you're listening or you've been blessed by this, send in some cash. Why? Because the doors of the church must stay open. This is not going to last forever. But the work of the church has to go forward. We're actually here. We gave out a blessing to people during the time. We had all kinds of blessings. We gave bags. They didn't have the income in the church. We brought the bags to your car. So if you want to find out when we're doing that thing, you can call us at the church here, the Father's House. You'll find that on our website. Just because what I'm saying, we're going to serve even during this time. Now, let me just say this to you. Give, 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 give. You got to give. I don't want you to hold back at a time like this. And now, lastly, I'm asking you right now to join me as we seek God like never before. I do believe that we're at what I call the brink of a great revival. I'm going to be talking about faith in crisis on this Thursday night. Join us on our Zoom. I'll be back here next week. Join us. Share this thing that you've seen, that you've heard. If you hear anybody that needs to hear this, share it. Share it, share it, so it can spread around the world. Lord, I thank you so much for your anointing of this time. We bless you, and I just pray that the power of the word is exploding inside of people even now. We're not the same. We bless you for this now. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you for being with us.